Adelaide to complete the magnificent Savile Seven, your eldest sister, Mary.
You've done me again.
Last time she did this, cost me a fortune. I hope you've paid.
Don't look at me.
It's going to cost you a fortune again.
Oh, I've got to sit down. Oh, where does Mary sit down?
Well, she's got a few words to say first. You kept a close watch, didn't you, Mary, on Jimmy's doings from down under?
Yes, definitely.
Yeah.
Not a word.
I'm your elder sister.
But first of all,
eldest sister.
You didn't actually think he was going to last that long originally, did you?
No. When he was a baby, about 4 months old, he fell out of his pram. And he was unconscious for the best part of 3 months. And Mother used to go to the St. Anne's Cathedral on a regular basis to pray for his recovery.
Hey? Is that me?
Yes.
That's you.
I was allowed another chance.
You were allowed another chance.
Thank God.
Your mother must have thought it was a miracle.
Oh, Mother definitely thought it was a miracle. Well, we all did.
Yes.
We all did. I mean, look what we've been landed with.
Thank you. Right.
That's enough. Put it down.
Marvellous. Put it down. Well, there are no signs of the golden locks, Jimmy, in this photograph of you as a 9-year-old desperate Dan. And you're happy to take a back seat to the Duchess here at the age of 13, shortly before leaving St. Anne's Elementary School in Leeds. You start work as an office boy for 13 shillings and ninepence a week, which converts, I think, to a good 68 pence in today's money. Now, Joan, what was he like when he was young, Jim?
Well, you want the truth or...
Well, let's have both of us.
This is a family show.
Actually, in those days, he used to try to help out quite a bit. Mum and Dad used to do quite a bit for social work, and they used to take him to the Borstal near us, where we lived.
Well, during the war, you'd do your bit down the mines as a Bevin boy, and it's a job you returned to after the war, following a brief venture into the scrap metal business. And, Jimmy, while working at the coalface, you have another brush with death. What happened?
Well, I got, through no fault of my own, a thing called blown up. And
your injury forces you to quit the mines, and this is the smart young man who applies for and gets a job as assistant manager at a dance hall in Leeds.
That's my brother Vince.
Well, he's a handsome devil, whoever he is. You're promoted to manage dance halls in Ilford and Manchester. In fact, you're so successful that you're invited to the London headquarters of Mecca to work as an assistant to the company boss, who is impressed by your showmanship.
You even managed to get the scaffold to work for you.
You still call him the boss, former chairman of Mecca, Eric Morley.
Hey, the man. How are you? Thank you for coming. Thank you for coming. Here's the governor. Here's the governor.
Eric, will you...
Habit dies hard.
It's his turn to do that now, then. Tell us the scaffold story, but not in reverse order, please.
Well, Jimmy could make an attraction out of anything, and I remember we were going to renovate the ceiling of this Leeds dance hall. We built this scaffold in the middle, and people kept complaining about they couldn't dance because of the size of the scaffold. And all of a sudden, the time came to take it down. Jimmy here decorated it all with bunting all the way around and announced, "Come and say goodbye to the scaffold." He stood outside with his great cigar going like this, and we played to an all-time record of over 2,000 people in a dance hall that held 750.
Yes.
And of course, it's these marvellous talents of his which he's put to good cause to raise money for worthy causes. I'm proud to know you,
Jim. I'll take the bonus now.
All right.
Thank you, Eric Morley. Now, as a dance hall manager, you decide you should know how to handle yourself in case of any aggro. You get to grips with a new sport as a professional wrestler. Among your opponents is this character we see walking to the ring. Now, he is in Ashby de la Zouche this evening, where he's getting warmed up for a match. A giant of British wrestling, Big Daddy.
Hiya, Jim. I raise my hat to you, Sir James Savile, for the sweat, hard knocks, and blood.
Yes.
that you spilled in wrestling.
That's right.
In this world, there are talkers and doers. And you, sir,
are a talker.
Are a doer.
Or a doer.
Jimmy Savile, champion of champions. Oh. God bless you.
Oh, dear.
Go get 'em, champ.
Thank you for coming.
But away from the wrestling ring, you start grabbing attention by having your hair dyed canary yellow. It's lovely. You catch not only the eye, but also the ear with your pioneering disc jockeying at the dance halls. And in 1957, you're invited to join the record spinners at Radio Luxembourg. You have a major impact on a pop industry still in its infancy and ripe for the sort of image and impetus that you are about to give it with your distinctive microphone technique. Your approach to broadcasting has an influence on a whole parade of disc jockeys.
You came first and the rest of us followed many years later.
Ooh, certainly Tony. Did, but I thought you were going to put my career up in smoke.
They worked with you at Radio Luxembourg in the early days, Tony Blackburn and Dave Cash.
Hey. Hey, Dave. Hey, this is Radio Forever. Thank you very much for coming down here, guys. Tremendous. Oh, yeah. Hey, how about this? Capital Radio's best here.
Yeah. And you look so smart.
So well, we knew it was Sir James.
We made an effort.
And Dave, you said you were light or something.
Well, almost. In the early days of Luxembourg, we used to be down on Harper Street, and the first time I met him, he came into Luxembourg Studios, and he went, "Oh, Dave Cash. Ah, very good, very good." And he said, "Smoke this," and he gave me a cigar, right, one of the big ones. Now, I took three puffs of it, went green. I've never smoked since, not cigars. Uh-huh. And I must tell you, I want to give it you back now after 20 years.
Thank you. Wonderful. It's all smoking,
Tony, your turn.
Well, when I was at boarding school,
eh?
I used to listen to you actually, Jim, and we used to have to switch the radio off after 8:30, and I used to listen to you underneath the bedclothes with the old radio there, and I've had, to my knowledge, four radios confiscated listening to your programme, and I want them back.
Yeah.
Right.
Thank you, Tony Blackburn and Dave Cash.
Thanks a lot, guys. Thank you.
While you're claiming the public's attention at the microphone, in private you're involved in a world far away from show business.
Eh?
You spend your spare time working as a voluntary porter at Leeds General Infirmary, and you start to put pressure on people to help out with donations and presents to pass on to patients.
There was one donation which gave us quite a hang-up.
Yes, he was the chief porter at Leeds General Infirmary, Charles Halligan.
Oh, yeah, Charles.
Charles, what was the hang-up?
The hang-up? Well, Jimmy and I used to go on quite a few public appearances, not public appearances, but factories and shops and what have you, and we used to get what were called plunder.
Plunder?
Remember?
Plenty plunder.
But once he sent, brought to me, mind you, six boxes of bras. Remember those bras?
Yeah.
They didn't fit anybody. No. They were that size.
They were meant for the Russian army, were they?
They were, I'm afraid so.
Thank you very much.
You're right. 600 bras, Charles. Yes, yeah.
In 1964, BBC Television launches a revolutionary new music programme meant to mirror the swinging 60s. And you are picked as one of the pioneer presenters of Top of the Pops.
Even in those days of black and white television, you managed to bring colour to the screen.
Oh, it's himself.
He was with you on Top of the Pops, yeah. David Jacobs.
Yeah. Hey. Not one day older than man.
No, it's amazing. Huh?
28.
Trim figure, my goodness.
28.
Tell us about the early days with Jimmy.
Well, I tell you, the extraordinary thing was that I was particularly bothered because when Top of the Pop started, Jimmy was the first of the presenters and I was to be the second. And you see, he was wearing more outrageous gear than the artist that he was going to introduce, and his hair was even longer, and I thought perhaps they might expect that of me.
Yes.
Unfortunately, it fell off me and grew on him.
Yeah. Terrific.
But what you became, Jim, was a great broadcaster, both on radio and television.
I apologize.
And that means that you are a brilliant communicator.
Oh, I apologize.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
But here is the Savile style in full flow as you present a Top of the Pops Christmas special in 1967.
So, I'll tell you what we're doing now, ladies and gentlemen. Top groups, top records, top everything. So how's about we have a nice record now by what is definitely one of the top groups, in fact, it was voted the top group in the rhythm and blues section this year, 1967, for no other down deep one, and only the Rolling Stones.
On, they're still going strong and spending some of the night together with us, Rolling Stone Bill Wyman.
Hi, Jimmy, on your special day. Do you remember me in those days? Well, I remember you as one of the only two DJs that supported the Stones in 63, 64. I've got a few photos that might interest you.
Hey? No crumpet.
See this one. Shame about the sandals. And anyway, great congratulations and it's wonderful to see you up there. And we need more DJs like you.
God help us.
Thank you, Bill Wyman. One of the million and one things you've managed to do with your life, Jimmy, is to develop close ties with the Royal Marines.
And we made a mistake, Jimmy, in thinking you'd prove too soft.
Your friend Colonel Alan Hooper, and with him three more of your longtime Royal Marine pals, ex-Captain Chris Good, Lieutenant Neil Fisher, and Regimental Sergeant Major Steve Perry.
I don't believe it. Hello,
Governor.
How are you?
Wonderful. Alan Hooper, Jimmy is no softy then.
He'd been doing some charity walks for from Land's End to John O'Groats, and we were impressed with that, and as a result, you were awarded our famous Green Berry, and you've been an honorary Royal Marine member at Lymston ever since.
Do you remember that time when you did that nine-miler? With the three broken ribs.
Three broken ribs, yeah.
And over there, the man who gave you the three broken ribs, gentlemen, Jerry Lee.
Oh.
Thank you, Royal Marine. Well, while doing your radio programs like Savile's Travels and launching the amazingly popular Jim'll Fix It in 1975, you find time to become a member of the I'm Backing Britain campaign and give your support to charity functions the length and breadth of the country. But there is one hospital that has a special place in your affections, Stoke Mandeville Hospital, for which you've helped raise more than £10 million. Well, and here are two friends of yours, Sue Duffy and her 14-year-old daughter, Charlotte.
Hi, Jim. It was 10 years ago when Charlotte was brought here to Stoke Mandeville after receiving terrible injuries in a car accident. In that time, we've seen Charlotte come to terms with her paralysis and take an active part in all that's going on around her. Thanks, Jim, for always being around and helping with Charlotte. For that, we'll always be grateful.
Hi there, Jimmy. Thanks for everything, and I send you my love. Here's a message from just a few of your friends here.
The team.
Thanks very much. Well, it's thanks to all at Stoke Mandeville, and in particular to Sue and Charlotte Duffy, who are with us on the set over here. You're continuing to raise money for that hospital, but there's an exciting new project that's going to take up a major part of your time during the 1990s. Now, Janet Rowe, you've been Jimmy's assistant for over 20 years.
Was.
Before you leave his employ, can you tell us about it?
Yes, Jimmy has a dream, and he usually makes dreams come true. He gave me away at my wedding recently, and he took a menu card and scribbled a magic castle and a yellow brick road, a fairy castle, on the back. And before the reception had ended, he'd done a deal with an architect who was also a guest at my wedding to make the project happen. And indeed, it's going ahead now in Peterborough, so we're all busy looking for funds to get it off the ground.
Oh, astonishing. Roger Audish. Now, Roger, another good friend of yours, as producer of Jim'll Fix It.
Was.
As ex-producer of Jim'll Fix It, you have a closer insight than most people into the real Jimmy Savile.
Well, I think so, Michael, but you can't be sure.
Bye-bye.
I know this much. He's a very generous man, which you wouldn't acknowledge, I expect. Very generous with his most precious commodity, time.
Oh.
My wife, Susie, here, is our chief letter reader on Jim'll Fix It, and the fact that she gets through about 250,000 of them a year is proof, I think, not only of the popularity of the programme, but the high regard people have for the man himself.
Oh. One of your great mates made a knockout impression when he appeared on Jim'll Fix It. Oh. Taking the cart there, Frank Bruno, now taking a break from panto rehearsals at Nottingham to deliver this message.
Oh.
Hello there, cheeky legs. As a genie in Aladdin, I'm a Mr. Fix-It. But even with my magic lamp, I can't match the wonderful things you do to fix for hundreds of kids. As a genie who grants wishes, oh master, I wish you many more years of fixing it, and I hope you have a lot more miles left in those old chicken legs, if you know what I mean. Good luck, Jimmy. Nice one.
Thank you, Frank. Of all the marathons you've run for charity, Jimmy, were laid end to end as one straight course. It would go from London to Chicago.
But you've
never known the loneliness of the long-distance runner because you're always accompanied by four special running mates, and they're here tonight to say hello. Neil Littlewood, Howard Silverman, Jimmy Corrigan, and Alan Flamey, and your support team member, Dave Sloan. All your fundraising efforts, Jimmy, have certainly not gone unnoticed nor unrecognized. You were awarded the OBE in 1970. Our former Prime Minister, Margaret Thatcher, and she's asked for the most distinctive approach to fitness training. Some might even say it was a little eccentric. But then so many great Britons have had a touch of eccentricity about them, and Jimmy is truly a great Briton. Miner, wrestler, dancehall manager, disc jockey, hospital porter, fundraiser, performer of good works, officer of the most excellent order of the British Empire, and knight of the realm, Jimmy, I and millions more salute you, God bless, and thank you, signed, Margaret Thatcher. Now, Jimmy, there's somebody who particularly wanted to be here tonight. He is severely disabled, but you've helped him by continually taking time out to encourage and advise him. Your good friend, Michael Wise.
The Michael. Come here, the Michael. Come here. Come here. You gangster. Where did you nick the clothes from?
Can't tell you that.
I bet you don't tell these ladies and gentlemen what your nickname for me is. Coward.
No.
I don't want to.
I just wanted to come and to ask you.
I'll put the word in this week. All right then.
Good luck.
Terrific.
Likewise. Oh. Thank you very much.
No more.
As we've heard, nowhere are your efforts better appreciated than at St. Anne's Elementary School.
And tonight I'm here to say a sincere thank you.
Yes, consultants specialising in spinal injuries at St. Anne's Elementary School, Dr. Hans Frankel.
Oh, hey. Thank you for coming. Thank you for coming.
Doctor.
Wait a minute. Yes, all right. Yeah, I should sit down quickly, apparently. Yes. Not a word.
He is the man who's made the impossible possible. We call him Boss.
Oh, that's right.
We call him Sister.
Spinal injuries.
Savile. Yeah. We have had other benefactors, but they just gave us money. He comes back and checks on his investment. Keep coming, Jimmy.
Okay, boss.
Thank you.
Okay.
So, Jane Savile, where do you know? Thank you.